Okay, so it's 5:30, let's get started. For the people who just entered, this is not the Scaling Up talk by Lukasz Szymanski. He couldn't give his talk at this moment, so the organizers asked me to do this talk as a substitute. Feel free to join in. So this talk is an introduction to the semantic web. That's a fairly vast topic. It's far more than we can cover here in 1 hour. So I will be giving you kind of a broad overview, explaining to you what the semantic web can do for you, what it means, what technologies power with, and what are their strengths and limitations. And to do so in 1 hour, we will need to cut some small corners, but there will be something new and interesting for everyone, probably. So what this talk is not about. Usually when you hear the term semantic, it is about the semantic meaning of HTML elements, right? People who say, hey, you should use strong instead of a bold tag, or you should use a header instead of a div because it's more semantically correct and attaches more meaning to your HTML. This talk is not about HTML, so if you were hoping for that, you can still sneak out at the back door. But it is about attaching a meaning to things. So what is the semantic web? I can probably best illustrate that by an example. Suppose you're a huge fan of Ed Sheeran and you want to visit one of his next concerts, right? How would you do it on the web as it was a couple of years ago? Well, you go to his website and you look at his concert dates and you see that next Tuesday there's a concert of Ed Sheeran in Tampa, Florida. So you want to go there and you want to know what kind of clothes to bring, right? Because when it's sunny, you need to take your shorts and otherwise you need to take a sweater, something. So you go to a weather website and look up the weather for Tampa, Florida, and you see that Tuesday it will be sunny with 86 degrees. What? That's pretty hot in my opinion. And then you remember that the Americans use some insane system for temperatures and that you need to convert the temperature from degrees Fahrenheit to Celsius. So you look up a Fahrenheit to Celsius conversion formula and plug your values in and you know what clothes to bring because you know what the temperature will be. And this is what we call Web 1.0. And it's a web of documents, right? It's all just web pages and it's meant for human consumption. You read the data on the web page, you combine it with other data and you interpret it. And then came along Web 2.0, and there were APIs and feeds, and they made everything so much better. So now, in Web 2.0, we have a feed of events on the Ed Sheeran website, but that still doesn't tell us everything. That feed may be either in iCalendar or in vCalendar format, so we must know which one it is before using it. And there, in that event feed, there may be different types of events. They may not all be concerts. It may all be also be signing sessions or something, or a CD release party. So we still don't know everything to use the data in an automated fashion. And the same for the weather forecast. With Web 2.0, we may have an API for a weather forecast, but we still don't know everything to use that in an automated fashion. We still have to write custom code because it may be either XML or JSON. And we don't know what fields and properties this API expects and returns, and in which units all the temperatures are. We just saw that the difference between Fahrenheit and Celsius is fairly large. So this is Web 2.0. It's a web of individual APIs. And we can consume that by software, but we need specialized software. We need to write software against a specific API, tailored to that API, and then we can use it for that API, but not for another API or to combine data from different APIs, because we need to write also other software for that. And the semantic web is what aims to solve this problem. So how would this all go with under the vision of the semantic web? Well, with the semantic web, you would just ask your question to a smart agent or PA on your phone, like Siri. You would just ask, hey, what's the weather like at the place where Ed Sheeran will give his next concert? And then that agent will search the web across all kinds of different sources, combine this data and reason about it, and then answer your question for you. So you don't have to do anything custom. And that's what's called the semantic web, or also sometimes Web 3.0. And that's a web of linked data. So all the data on the web is linked together, and it's meant for consumption by intelligent agents or PAs. So this stuff must be all new and shiny and things like that. Well, it's not that revolutionary. The term semantic web was first coined by Tim Berners-Lee, one of the inventors of the web as we know it, in 2001. So it's already more than 15 years old. And the standards that power the semantic web are also not new. The semantic web is based on RDF, RDFS, Sparkle, and OWL, which are all between 10 and 20 years old. This is not new, but it's regaining some traction right now, and that's why it's interesting, and I think that still the division of the semantic web will eventually happen. So let's look at some of the standards right now. The cornerstone of the semantic web is formed by RDF, the Resource Description Framework. And what RDF does is, well, it records statements about things. We intentionally say statements because we don't know whether these statements are true. People can say anything on the web. They can claim anything. So it's just things that people claim, but oh, they might not be truths. But what's so special about RDF, right? We have other standards to record statements about things. We have XML and JSON, and we have databases. Well, RDF has a special feature, and that is that it allows agents to read, merge, relay, and infer statements from data without fully understanding the meaning of that data. That sounds pretty scary, but we'll get to that. So what does RDF look like? Well, RDF is actually just a table like this. A table with three columns, a subject, a predicate, and an object. And those are meant to be interpreted in the grammatical sense. And every row in the table represents a statement. And because each such statement consists of three parts, we also call it a tuple. So let's look at some RDF data. I will make some RDF data about myself. So my name is Arnoud, and I can say that I work at Moxio, which is the company I work for. And in that case, I would be the subject, the predicate is works at, and the object is Moxio. It's just like a sentence, actually. And I can add some more data. I can add my Twitter handle. I can say that I live in Delft, which is a city in the Netherlands, and that the company I work for is also based in Delft. So what you see here is that some values have quotes around them, and that is because they are values, as opposed to kind of things with an identity. Compare it to value objects and entities when doing DDD. So the things with quotes are just values that have no identity, and other things point to actual objects, concepts with an identity. And you can already see that some of these subjects and objects occur multiple times in the list. And that allows them, by combining these, that allows us to generate another representation of the same data, namely as a graph. So this is the same data. We have turned the subjects and objects into nodes, and all the predicates we have turned into edges, and now we have a graph representing the same RDF data. Well, what's so special about this structure now? Well, suppose we have this data set that we just had, and we have a second data set. A data set with information about the Netherlands. Suppose it's about the Dutch, it's coming from the Dutch Statistical Office or something. Like that the Netherlands has Amsterdam as its capital and has a population of about 70 million. How would we combine this information? Well, it's pretty easy. We have two tables, each has three columns and a couple of rows. So, well, we just put the rows together. Data is merged. And if we then turn this into a graph, we have a graph and we have linked the data together. So this is the concept of linked data. You can easily merge data from all different sources to form a giant graph. Well, now you ask, how do I put this data into a file, all right? Do I need to open up Microsoft Word and create a table with three columns and then save it or something? Well, RDF is an abstract data format, which means that it's just about the concept of the triples with the three columns. And there are different serialization formats. What you see here is Turtle. It's a text-based format, and it's pretty readable, and it's also pretty usable to write this by hand. But there's also RDF over XML, which is an XML representation of RDF. This data, it means exactly the same, it's just written down in XML here. And you can also put RDF data in JSON. Then they call it JSON link data, or JSON LD. And there's even RDFA, which allows you to embed RDF metadata into HTML markup. So it is not about the way you put RDF into a file, but about the data model behind it. So we say that RDF is an abstract data model, and there are different serialization formats. Now there's an important topic we need to talk about when merging this data. And that's the concept of identity. What you see here is Amsterdam. It's a ship called Amsterdam. And it was an 18th century ship used by the Dutch Indian Company to sail to the East Indies and trade goods and spices. Well, actually, this is not a ship. It's a replica, because the original lies wrecked on the bottom of the English Channel. And this can be seen at the Maritime Museum in Amsterdam, the ship. So suppose our Dutch National Maritime Museum publishes some RDF data about the ship, because they're very, very modern, and they think, hey, we should publish this data as RDF. So they have data about the ship, namely that it has 42 guns and that its current status is wrecked. And now we also had the data set about the Netherlands that we had earlier, namely that the Netherlands has capital Amsterdam and about its population. And now suppose that we try to merge these two data sets together. Well, what we would then get is that the capital of the Netherlands is wrecked and has 42 guns. And this is clearly not what we wanted. So we need some way to distinguish multiple things with the same name. So what do we use for naming things and identifying things on the web? We use a URI. So instead of identifying something with only a name, instead we identify certain concepts with a URI. So in this case, we could identify the ship Amsterdam with a URI pointing somewhere to the website of the National Maritime Museum. And we could identify the city of Amsterdam by some URI from the Lonely Planet or something. It doesn't really matter. It's only attaching a different URI to a concept. These URIs get quite long though, and they are difficult to write down by hand each time. So they have a solution for that also, and those of you who have worked with XML schema-based things, they know that, probably. Prefixes and queue names. So we split the URIs into a namespace part and a local name, and for these namespaces we define prefixes that we can use instead of the namespace name. And this combination is then called a queue name or a qualified name. So instead of using the full Lonely Planet URI, we just say Lonely Planet colon Amsterdam. So then we get something like this. And in the remainder of this talk, I will just not define namespaces and prefixes, but just assume that, well, prefixes point to an appropriately defined namespace. There are three fundamental laws of the semantic web. Actually, they're not tied to the semantic web only. It's about data on the web. Because the web is so messy and vast, you need to take some things into account when working with data from the web. And that's true for any application of the web. It's just that the semantic web formalizes these laws into formal statements. And it tries to embrace the messiness of the web. So let's look at this. Suppose we have data from the Lonely Planet in different languages. And this is all about the city of Brussels. So in English they call it Brussels, in Dutch they call it Brussel, in French they call it Bruxelles. I don't even know how to pronounce it Chinese, but still, this is all about the same concept, namely the city of Brussels. And also, even within the same namespace, this can happen, right? We could use MI6007 as a Q name and MI6 James Bond, but they clearly refer to the same secret agent. So different names do not necessarily imply that things are different concepts, and that's something we must need to take into account, because the web is so fast, it can be that people invent different terms for the same thing and put it on the internet. So that this is called the non-unique naming assumption, and it's just that we, just because something has a different name, we cannot conclude that it is a different thing. Another law has to do with truth and authority. Suppose Donald Trump is also very modern, and well, he tweets a lot, but now he also publishes his tweets in RDF, because that's really cool. So he could say, he defines some namespaces, and he could say that Obama tapped him. We don't know whether this is true. Most of us might think that he lies here. I don't know. It doesn't matter. He has the right to say so, right? So we cannot know for sure that this data is true. In the same sense, Donald Trump can also have an opinion about CakePHP, that it's much better than Symfony. Right? He can also publish that in RDF and put it on the web. He's allowed to do so. Nobody should stop him doing so, right? It's just if we consume this data, well, we have to take into account that he may not be an expert on this topic. And also the namespaces he uses. He does not need permission to publish something with an URI in the PHP fake namespace or something. You don't have to be an authority to say something about a topic. And this is called the AAA slogan. On the web, anyone can say anything about any topic. And that's also the power of the web, right? It has always been that anyone in the old days could open Notepad, type some HTML into it, and put it on the web for everyone to see. You didn't need anything for that. And just because it's so easy, the barrier to entry is so low, it also means that there's a lot of data that, well, does not really come from an expert or an authority. The third law has to do with this slide. I could have said a lot on this slide. I could have said that, well, CakePHP is much better than Symfony. I could have said that my favorite color is blue, but I didn't. Does that mean that my favorite color is not blue? No. Let's look at Donald Trump again. He knows a lot about PHP frameworks. We have RDF data that Donald Trump knows Symfony, he knows CakePHP, he knows CodeIgniter. What does this tell us about Donald Trump's knowledge of Laravel? Does he know anything about it? We don't know exactly, right? Just because it's not stated that something is true, that doesn't mean that it is false. And this is called the open world assumption. We can never have all the information, so we can never draw any conclusion from absence of information. And these are three things that we will encounter in the rest of this talk. Keep that in mind. So we now have all this RDF data, and we want to do something with that. We want to access it. We know what to keep into account right now. So there's a query language called Sparkle, and it's a query language made for semantic web data. If we have RDF data, we will probably first put that into a triple store, where a triple store is just a fancy word for a database for RDF triples. And it's a bit like a specialized graph database. And if we have data in such a triple store, we can execute Sparkle queries on it. And this is an example of a Sparkle query. And it's a bit like pattern matching. We just put in some placeholders with a question mark before them, describing RDF triples that we want to match. Those are in the where clause here. So this query will give us all the employees and their companies who work at a company based in Delft. Anything that matches this pattern will be returned. So if we execute that against the data you saw earlier, we should get back that I work at a company, namely Moxio, based in Delft. Right. In the same way, we can use, here we use the fixed value, Delft. We don't even need to use any fixed value, it's just patterns. Here, this is a query for all the employees who work at a company which is based in the same city they live in themselves. Well, we can also execute that. Anything that matches the pattern gets returned. There are a number of online Sparkle endpoints, and one of the biggest of them is DBpedia, which is actually all the information in the Wikipedia info boxes, the little boxes you see on the right with a picture above them and things like that, digitalized into RDF data. And we can also execute Sparkle queries against such an endpoint. So for example, we could execute this query, which would give us the songs from the Beatles ordered by their runtime. So the Beatles songs with the longest runtimes. And we can just execute that against DBpedia, and we get back a list like this, and we see that Digit is the longest Beatles song. Actually, Digit occurs multiple times in this list, probably because it has multiple variations, multiple variants that have a different runtime. If we have all this RDF data, shouldn't we have something like a schema to it to make some sense of the amount of data that we have? Right? We know for JSON and XML, there's JSON schema and XML schema. Maybe we can do the same with RDF. Well, there's RDF schema, which is the schema language for semantic web data. And just like XML schema describes the structure of XML documents using XML, and JSON schema describes the structure of JSON data in JSON, RDF schema describes the structure of RDF data in RDF. So with RDF schema, it's possible to define classes and properties and the domains and ranges of properties. We will see them soon. And a kind of inheritance of classes and inheritance of properties. And contrary to JSON schema and XML schema, where you usually have a separate schema file, we can here just put the schema in the same file as the data. Or not. It doesn't matter, because when we can so easily merge the data together, it doesn't matter whether it's in the same file. We can just put it together. So let's look at some RDF schema. Suppose we have data about Donald Trump, that he is the father of Ivanka Trump. Right? And we can now add some RDF schema statements to that. We can say that his father of has a range person. So that means that the thing that goes to the right, the object corresponding to the predicate is father of, will be always be a person. And we can have that the domain of is father of, so the thing that goes to the left of it, the subject, always is a father. Yeah? Because when someone is a father of someone, that person is a father. And we can also say that father is a subclass of a parent, because every father is a parent, and every parent is a person. And we can also say that if someone is a father of someone else, that also implies that that person is a parent of someone else. Now, the main feature of RDFS is that we can infer new triples from this data. So, from the fact that the range of his father of is a person, we can infer that Ivanka Trump, which is used as the object in the first line, must be a person. And in the same way, we can infer that Donald Trump must be a father, and therefore a parent, and therefore a person. And because the subproperty relationship, we can infer that Donald Trump is a parent of Ivanka Trump. You can see here the RDF type things, and those are kind of like an instance of in programming languages. But in programming languages, you can only have one class, one concrete class, usually, but RDF allows for kind of multiple inheritance or multiple typing. So keep that in mind. This process of inferring new data or deriving new data from old data and RDFS schema is called inference. And the original triples that we put in are called the asserted triples, and the new triples that we inferred are called the inferred or the virtual triples. And the inference is done by something called a reasoner. And this is a recursive process. We can put back the inferred or virtual triples in the reasoner again and infer even more information and more and more. As long as we can infer new triples, we can continue this process. Usually, Sparkle endpoints also understand RDFS. So if we would execute a Sparkle query on the data we had earlier, and we ask for all the things that are a person, we would get back both Ivanka Trump and Donald Trump, because the reasoner can conclude that both must be a person. This inference also allows us to combine data easily. Suppose we have two data sets from different sources. And because they are different sources, they use kind of different terminology. We can have a data source that says that Donald Trump is a person, and we can have another data source that says Melania Trump is a human, right? So if we want to merge this data together, it doesn't really align that well, because, well, a person should also be a human, right? It's kind of the same. So what we can do is just add some mapping rules using RDFS. We can say that a person is a subclass of a human, and conversely, that a human is a subclass of a person, so that every person is a human and every human is a person. And if we then just merge this together and apply a reasoner to that, we would get back that Donald Trump is also a human, like Melania Trump, and Melania Trump is also a person, like Donald Trump. And this allows us to query different sources as if they were one, as long as we have appropriate mapping rules between them. Now, we've seen a lot of similarities between RDF schema and JSON and XML schema, in a sense. But there's also an important difference. Suppose we have this data set that we obtained somehow from the MI6. And it says that James Bond is a secret agent, and it tells us that James Bond has one gun, okay? But we made a typo here, or small error. We used the number of guns property we saw earlier in the dataset from the National Maritime Museum. And they have RDFS data about that property. They say that its domain, so the things that go to the left of it, is a ship. So clearly this is wrong, right? We used the wrong property, so we expect that our schema will tell us that and give an error and say, hey, you made a mistake. No, RDFS won't do that. It will just apply a reasoner and conclude that James Bond is a ship. And this is actually just the way things work with RDFS, and it's something to keep in mind. Actually, contrary to JSON schema and XML schema, RDF schema will never consider data to be invalid, as long as it's valid RDF. It will just, RDFS is not powerful enough to contradict yourself. So it will just infer new triples and just assume that it's correct. The conclusions may just be a bit strange. There's a way to draw even smarter conclusions, and that's done using the web ontology language, which is aptly called OWL. And OWL is, in a sense, similar to RDFS++. It allows for more inferencing possibilities, but that power comes at a price, and we will see this a bit later. So what OWL allows us to do is, for example, inverse properties. If we have data that Donald Trump is a parent of Ivanka Trump, and we have some OWL schema that is parent of, is the inverse of, is child of, then we can conclude that Ivanka Trump is a child of Donald Trump because of the inverse of property. There are also symmetric properties, so that a relation that holds one way must also hold the other way. So if we say that Donald Trump is married to Melania Trump, and we say that is married to is a symmetric property, so it must hold both ways, then we can conclude that Melania Trump should also be married to Donald Trump, which makes sense. There's also the concept of equality, which kind of deals with the non-unique naming issues. So if we have data that Donald Trump is married to Melania Trump, and we say that Donald Trump is the same as the Don, which may be a nickname for him, then we can conclude that also the Don is married to Melania Trump, because, well, they're one and the same person. So if the one is married to someone, the other should too. And there's also functional properties, which are just properties that can only have one value. So someone can only have one father, in a sense. You might argue whether this is true, but suppose you say someone has only one father, in the sense of a biological father, then Ivanka Trump has a father, Donald Trump, and if Ivanka Trump then also has a father, the Don, and if has father, if we declare that as a functional property, which makes sense, then our reasoner would conclude that the Don must be the same as Donald Trump, right? Because you can only have one father. So the two fathers, or the two names of fathers that we have, must point to the same person. But this can also lead to inconsistencies. Suppose if instead of, in the last example, we add an extra asserted triple that says that the Don is different from Donald Trump. And suppose we now put this into a reasoner, right? We just saw that from the first three triples, we should conclude that Donald Trump and the Don are the same. But now we explicitly state that they are different. What will our reasoner do with it? Well, it will say, I can't do anything with this. And that's what's called an inconsistency. The power of OWL lets us construct data that contradicts itself. And a reasoner cannot do anything about that anymore, because it does not know what to believe anymore. It knows that something is wrong, but it doesn't know which of the ones are then right. So the reasoner will just give up, not draw any conclusions anymore, and report it to us as an inconsistency. It will sort of try to point out where the error is. So it will show a couple of triples and properties that relate to the problem. So in this case, it tries to show us that the problem is in the different from in combination with the functional property has father. But the explanation can be quite obscure, and that makes it quite difficult to recover from such inconsistencies. And these inconsistencies, they will happen, and it's okay, right? Remember the AAA slogan, anyone can say anything about any topic. So we can also say data that contradicts ourselves, right? We are allowed to do so. It's part of the deal. Just remember, a reasoner will never help you anymore, and that's what you get back. So if you're interested in these topics and want to know more about it, first let's see whether you've understood what we've been talking about. So I have a kind of a self-test. We have some RDF data. George has a child, Michelle, and George also has a child, James. How many children does George have? Okay. Let's see hands. Anyone for two? Two or more? Two or more? Yeah? One or more? One or more? We don't know? We don't know at all? Maybe?
No, no idea, because we don't know if Michelle can be the same as James or not.
Exactly. Okay. So there are multiple things that play a role here, right? The non-unique naming assumption, Michelle and James may refer to the same person, right? Michelle may have become James later in her life, or his life now, I think. Michel may be a nickname for James that his friends give him. I don't know. Might be. There might be more children, right? The open world assumption. We may never assume that we have all the information. So George can have a third child or a fourth. We don't know. And even then, but that probably depends on where we got this data from and whether we trust that as an authority on this data. Well, this might be all lies. Someone can just open up an internet page and put there that George has two children and, well, may not be true. So indeed, depending on how we value the truth of the source of this data, it's either we don't know at all or one or more probably. So if we want to make use of the semantic web, there's obviously a network effect, right? Using the semantic web is only useful when we can link data together, and that's only possible when multiple parties use the same language, if they use the same terms and concepts. Because we can only do something useful with data if we can link to other data. So therefore, if you start using these technologies, it's important to align with existing vocabularies that are out there. And that doesn't mean that we have to use these vocabularies directly. We can also use our own vocabulary, but just define mapping rules between our vocabulary and another vocabulary that is popular. We have seen that we can use RDFS subclass off to map two data sets together to align them. And in the same sense, we can use RDFS subproperty off, owl inverse off, and same as to signify that some things in our vocabulary are the same as other things in another vocabulary. We can just use our own model and map it onto an existing one. So there are many existing vocabularies that are widely used. One of the most popular and oldest ones is the Dublin Core. Maybe you have actually used it. Some HTML metadata has a DC colon prefix, right? That stands for Dublin Core, and it is about metadata for publications and authors. There's Friend of a Friend, which was a kind of RDF attempt at a Facebook-like thing before Facebook even existed. So it allows you to describe people and their connections and make up kind of a social network. There's Good Relations, which describes products and prices and all other e-commerce-like topics. And that's also what can be used by things like Google Shopping to get shopping data from your website and compare it and give you the best prices. And there's also CBNL, which is a Dutch initiative to make a standard vocabulary for construction and infrastructure and spatial planning. So it talks about things like bridges and concrete, things like that. There's QUDT, which is from NASA, and it is about quantities and units and dimensions and conversions between all those different units, so that a computer knows how Celsius relates to Fahrenheit and knows how to convert between the two, as long as you annotate your data with those QUDT vocabulary. There's a lot of software for using and consuming the semantic web. The semantic web is kind of a Java world. So the most popular semantic web framework is Apache Jenna. It's a large tool set, but it's all written in Java. There are some PHP projects for working with RDF and Sparkle. EasyRDF and ARC2, both can be found on Packagist. There are different open source OWL reasoners, Fact++, Hermit, and Palette. And there's also Protégé, which is an RDF OWL IDE with various reasoner plugins, and that's also the source of the screenshot of the reasoner I showed you. For knowing more about the semantic web, this is kind of the Bible of the semantic web. It's the book Semantic Web for the Working Ontologist. It's really nice, fairly large overview of the semantic web with a lot of practical examples of what you can do with it. And there's also more information that can be found on the web. The W3C has a lot of information about the semantic web on its website and a wiki. There are primers about RDF and OWL, and information about Sparkle and the whole standard. One of the most difficult problems still with the semantic web is how to find and how to find data sets that follow this RDF format. DBpedia is a large source of information that you could use. There's also data.gov from the American government, which publishes all kinds of linked open data sets. And there's also logcloud.net, which is a sort of overview of all kinds of semantic web data sets that can be found on the net. So it's kind of a portal to find other data sets. So this was my talk. If you have any questions, you can ask them now. Then I get to throw this at you. And otherwise, you can talk to me on Twitter or find me here in the hallway. I'm always happy to answer whatever you would like to know. And if you attended this talk, please also leave feedback on JoinedIn. Because this is a substitute talk, there probably isn't a LinkedIn JoinedIn URL yet. But please watch if there is one and tell me how I can improve this talk. Are there any questions? Okay.
Hi, I have a question. How to handle temporal or uncertain data in this way? How to handle it? Because maybe I believe these schemas are well defined, so this may not occur, but sometimes the expression is will be in the 2 years was. So how to handle?
Okay,
and I will ask the second question. Do these schemas are having already ontologies which we can use if we can find the ontologies for these schemas which are provided on the web? So I mean the rules which you presented an example in the OWL.
Okay, so for your first question, you asked.
About temporal data.
Oh yeah, about temporal things and truth.
And uncertainty.
Yes, uncertainty. What people do in this case is they don't make a statement like you would. They then make statements about a statement. So you can say, I have a statement. And that statement, subject, is valid from predicate, some date, object. That same statement is valid until subject, predicate, another date, object. Or you can say this person, subject, states that, predicate, this is true, or that statement, right? So in that case, you don't make the statement directly anymore, but you describe the statement as a concept itself. And then you say this statement says that, this statement has subject X, this statement has subject, has predicate Y, and this statement has object Z. And then you have set more or less the same, but just with the uncertainty in it. Your second question, I didn't really get that.
Actually, I asked if we have, for example, the schema for family connections, and we have the raw facts, because this is actually in the semantic web. We have some kind of ontology which you provided that if someone is granddaughter is a daughter of the daughter, it's a granddaughter. Do we have something like that attached to these schemas?
For family relations, I don't really know. It might be in friend of a friend, which is kind of a social network, right? So if on Facebook, you can also say who is your father and things like that. So there might be something defined in there. And I also think that people will research, family origins, etc. They might have also made something like that. But I don't know for sure. Maybe you can find it through LOD Cloud or something. Any other questions? All right, in that case, thank you very much.